will defend these police officers.
Listen to police officers' commands, listen to what we tell you, and just stop. The nation needs to realize that when we tell you to do something, do it. And if you're wrong, you're wrong. If you're right, then the courts will figure it out.
We don't get to pick the law, we enforce it. But at the end of the day, each and every man can go home safe. Sometimes the use of force is necessary. You need to comply with the police officer the way the system was meant to be. Comply with the orders of police officers. Resisting arrest is a real and dangerous crime.
Nonpartisan Liberty for All. I'm your host, Dave Bourne, and it is Thursday, May 21st, 2015, and resisting arrest is a dangerous crime because police will kill you for not obeying. And that's not an exaggeration. That's something that happens on a daily basis, unfortunately. So we are finally back, finally back with our End the Government Police Thursday show. As I had mentioned a few weeks ago, I was in Florida for my paying job. And the week prior to that, I believe we had canceled the Thursday show. And last week, I wasn't feeling that well also. So it's been about 3 weeks. So I'm sure there are so many things that have happened. There's probably hundreds of thousands of people that have been abused, beaten, killed, whatever you can possibly think of during that time. And again, it's, you know, you talk about these things and it's like, it sounds like, oh yeah, you know, they're just exaggerating or just joking or whatever. And it's really not. These are all things that happen all the time. They're things that happen on a daily basis, to the extent that I felt, and this was near the beginning of when I started the show, that I felt that we needed a whole show, a whole episode each week to discuss what's going on with the police. And when I say government police, just to kind of explain that for those who haven't listened before or who, you know, maybe don't totally understand what I mean, the police are backed by the government, obviously. They're soldiers for the government is really what they are. And I'm not just including the, you know, your local police department. I think that applies to any type of law enforcement, and maybe I should even change the name of it to, you know, and the government law enforcement. And I think that includes the military as well. I think people try to really stay away from that. It's like one of those, you know, third rail type things. Well, don't talk about this. The police pretty much are when it comes to politicians as well. Don't talk about the police. But the military, it's so extreme where, oh, well, thank you for your service. You don't know what the fucking person did. They could have been a cook somewhere. And I actually had a friend who had died, not in a battle, but actually when he had come back, he had died in a car accident, which he was a really nice kid, and I felt really bad about it. But he was a cook, not to take anything away from him. I mean, people need to eat too. But I mean, if you think about that, so, well, thank you for your service of feeding the troops who are going out essentially killing people for politicians and in many circumstances. So I want to talk a little about that tonight. Of course, our Thursday co-host Thomas Woody is a former military veteran. And even the term veteran, because I thought veteran used to mean that you had fought in a war. Now it's just like you've been enlisted in the military. So we'll get his perspective on that in a moment. But along with that, we'll talk all about recent police state news as we've been doing, and really getting into some of these other things where, you know, all of these things that go on, every law, every policy, whatever the government passes or enforces or whatever, it's all at the barrel of a gun, really. It's all based on force. And at what point do people start standing up? And I'm not talking about going after people, attacking people, or being violent. But on the other side of it, I am talking about self-defense. And this is another one of those things that people are afraid to say. And you have a number of people that will go out, you know, conduct civil disobedience, and then just, hey, well, come arrest me now. And, you know, I respect those people and what they do, and to actually go out there and, based on what they believe in, know that they're going to go to jail or they're going to be arrested or whatever's going to happen in that scenario. But where do you get to that point where it's like okay or acceptable or just common sense to defend yourself? So these are some of the things I want to talk about tonight, along with some of the stories that Thomas has prepared, you know, since he, I guess, took over as our Thursday night co-host. He's been doing a great job putting these stories together. And before I bring him on, I wanted to mention, because I was thinking about this last night as well, and I occasionally mention it also, that I feel like at this point that I have a great team of people that are helping with the show. I'm fortunately not as many as I had hoped on things like the back end part of it. But and that's something that Thomas actually has been helping with and helping with the Facebook page and stuff. And I really appreciate that, because obviously I don't make any money. So it's hard to nothing from nothing leaves nothing. So it's hard to pay people money when I'm not making any money myself. So I really appreciate everything everybody does. But I think that with the talent side of it, and the people that are co-hosting are just doing a great job. You know, Pete Murtha joins us every Tuesday. He has had some projects with work recently, so he's missed, you know, a few weeks here and there. But, you know, he's been doing a great job. Ellen Ball, who was even on Free Talk Live before for a while and had left just because of, you know, her job and not being able to fit it into her schedule. She does such a great job. I love having her on. And of course, Thomas and all the stuff that he does, and not only, you know, what he does while he's on the show, but the time he takes to put together the news for the week and going through all that, and then helping with the and the government police Facebook page, and just really kind of dedicating a lot of time to that. So I really do appreciate everything everybody does, and I just feel like I have the, you know, best team of people right now. And I feel like that everything, you know, how everything flows, and I think I have a good rapport with everybody while we're on the air, And I hopefully we'll just continue to get better. So I want to make sure that I do mention that and that everybody knows, you know, how much I really do appreciate what they're doing. Because, again, they're not getting paid. They're not really, you know, benefiting in any way. It's not like it's their show. And I don't mean that in a negative way, but what I'm saying is it's like, okay, well, it's kind of my vision. So it's not like they're getting something out of, hey, well, I'm creating my, you know, vision here of this show. Although I try to encourage people to, any ideas that they might have or any ways that they want to contribute or things that they want to do. But I just, you know, I can't thank everybody enough, because at this point, you know, I don't know that I would still be doing the show if it wasn't for, you know, Thomas and Ellen and Pete. And, you know, even like last night, I felt like I was just totally off, that it wasn't one of my best shows. And you know, of course, I have Ellen there to pick up that slack. And Ellen, of course, having more experience than, you know, me and all the different shows that she has done, you know, to this point. So I just can't thank everyone enough for everything that they've done. And I really, I enjoy it as well. So, you know, I enjoy doing the shows with everybody and the back and forth and, you know, throwing, you know, joking around here and there as well, and just having fun with it also, because that's important. Obviously, if you're not enjoying it, then you're doing something wrong. So, and speaking of doing something wrong, unfortunately, we had a slight issue with Spreaker, which is where we live stream everything. So that's why the show started late. It actually started on time, but nobody heard it. So it ended up from what people heard, they pretty much just heard it starting late. So I'm going to end my rant there and bring on my Thursday co-host, North Missouri Cop Blocks Thomas Woody. And be sure to go to Thomas's page and like it, to do some of those things. And people still, I don't think, realize, and we'll really have to talk about that in more detail on a show, what these people that are out there, you know, cop blocking, what they're risking, and not just what they're doing and, oh, well, they're just filming cops, but it goes way beyond that. It's not just, you know, filming cops from 50 feet away or something. I mean, it's, you know, putting themselves right out there, you know, filming stuff and right in the thick of things, and the police know who they are and they get targeted. And Kelly Patterson, who's a friend of mine and the friend of the show, who is the founder of Nevada Cop Block, we had talked about him being hit by a car in a hit and run. And a lot of the evidence, now again, this is just our opinion. We don't have any, I guess, what people would call pure evidence or whatever. But in our opinions and what we think, a lot of that points to the police being involved. So going out there and doing this stuff, and not only that, but all the shit that people take, it's like going out there and you're trying to help to literally defend people's freedoms, not like the military, who's going out there attacking countries in the Middle East, and whether it's from oil or preserving the dollar as the reserve currency or whatever, and supposedly, oh yeah, they're protecting our freedom. No, they're not, because who the fuck is protecting me from, you know, when the police want to just, you know, throw me around and leave giant bruises all over me? One of the pictures in the for the event, I create an event on Facebook for every show just to, you know, make sure that's out there, And one of the pictures is out there with, you know, a huge bruise on my arm. So, you know, the people that are trying to protect, and I always say trying because no matter what you do, I don't know how you can actually protect people's freedom, because the government is just, you know, with all the might and weapons and all of these things. But they're trying to do as much as they can to protect people's freedom. And they're ridiculed for it at the same time. So, you know, people that do that and really risking, to an extent, a lot of people are actually even risking their lives. They're definitely risking bodily harm. And they deserve a lot of credit for that. So I know there was a long rant there, but I felt like it is something that needs to be said, and that the people really deserve that credit. When people are sitting there and praising police and military and thank you for your service, and you know, you have all these people that are just putting down people that are really just dedicating themselves without any of the means, without getting paid any money, without any of the protection, nothing, going out there and doing this stuff. And they deserve a lot of credit. So now, with that being said, Thomas, I know, especially because we had canceled last week, that there are plenty of stories out there, as there are every day. But we're, of course, going to try to focus on some of the important ones. But what's been going on in the United Police States of Nazis? I got to find a better, I guess, term for that. United Police States of something. Maybe we can work on coming up with something better.
Well, thanks, Dave, for having me again. I really do appreciate you having me come on the show. And it can be difficult for people out there that, you know, actually want to be involved in what the true idea of what cop block really is. And it can be extremely scary, and that's why a lot of people are deterred from doing it. You see a lot of videos out there that, you know, people are standing back and they're just letting police do this crap. And when you actually get in the thick of it and you go up to these people and you tell them, hey, you're not doing your job properly, people can get offended. You know, if somebody came to your place of business and started telling you you're doing your job wrong, you'd be a little upset about it. And some of these people go to the extremes where they will use extreme force that is not short of killing you just to put their ego to rest. And why you're going to kill people because they told you you're doing your job wrong, when you know, 9 times out of 10, these people are doing their job wrong, and they're pissed off because people want to assert the rights that these people are claiming they're protecting, but they're doing the exact opposite.
And I want to get into that in detail a little later in the show as well, where this whole, you know, notion of the military, you know, protecting people's rights. And again, your former military. So we're not even just talking about, and of course I'm not, but it's not just an opinion of, well, if you were in the military, you wouldn't think that. But because you were in the military, and actually not only was Thomas in the military, but Pete Murtha, who's our Tuesday co-host, is in the military as well. So don't think that, you know, just because somebody's been in the military that they don't necessarily come to these conclusions. A lot of the time, that is why they come to these conclusions, because they see what really goes on.
Oh, yeah, we see it firsthand, you know. And then you get the people who are upper echelon, they got security clearances, and they read documents that really, really is counterintuitive to what we're telling the people that is paying us. We're not doing our job as, you know, as military members, when you're being paid simply to take orders. Don't question it. If I give you a gun and put you in an airplane and drop you thousands of miles away in the middle of a zone where you don't speak the language, and these people don't like you for whatever reason, it's not even your fault, they don't even know who you are, but they're going to shoot and kill you because you're an American, you're in combat uniform, and you've got a gun with live ammunition, and you're being told to kill them. And they give you the mentality of kill or be killed. And that does a number on some people. And lots of these people are coming back and they're, you know, getting into local law enforcement. And they've got mental health issues.
And that's actually the officer who had a gun to my fucking head was a former, I think he was even former military police. But there's a lot of stuff. I do want to get into that in detail later in the show. But for now, I know there's a lot of stories that you've been following. So what's been going on, you know, in the past few weeks with the police state?
Well, I can tell you, as if it wasn't, you know, bad enough out there already with encounters in police, now they've got a whole new system put into legislation by President Barack Obama, where they are alerted in what's being called a blue alert system. That establishes a network for alerting the police when there are active threats against police. So now you're going to have a bunch of jacked up officers out there that have paranoia issues because now they're being told active threats are being made against them. And now they're going to be extra trigger happy.
Yeah, and this is something I think we need to spend a little time on as well, because this is how insane the government and their bullshit is, and how people cannot see through it, I don't know. But you think about the fact of how many police are actually killed by people, and the majority of them, you know, they want to talk about police being targeted. You know, they have one or two police that are targeted. Now it's like, oh my God, you know, this is a epidemic now that people are targeting the police, which is a bunch of bullshit. The majority, which is probably something like 99%, are something where, you know, someone's being pursued for a crime, you know, and they shoot back at a cop or something like that. I think it was something like 40 total, and I don't even think that for 2014 was even cops that were killed by other people. What the other thing that they try to do is count all of these situations where police die because they're pursuing somebody. I remember looking at the amount of Las Vegas police that have died in like 20 years, which was like two or something. And, well, actually it may have been a little more because of the accidents, but I remember one that had died because he was going like 120 miles an hour for no reason. He didn't turn his lights on. Maybe he had a reason, but he didn't turn his lights on. You know, so they tried to distort it in that way as well. What the real fucking threat is the cops are the ones that are the threat to everybody else. Just like the government are the ones that are the threat to the people, not the other way around. What fucking threat are, you know, the majority of the people? Again, maybe you have some, you know, deranged lunatic out of, you know, millions of people. You know, you have a couple people here and there. I mean, look at how many Congress people have been killed, or how many, you know, people in government, or how many. I mean, the way that they being the government and government media are able to exploit this shit is insane. They're able to take, like, I think in one of the articles, and I don't know if it was in the one that you had read, but they talked about, you know, the two officers that were killed in New York that were targeted, which again is very rare in itself. And I think those were the first two officers killed in New York in years, at all. And try to totally exploit this and take this one thing. Now, if you look at the opposite, if you look at the people that are killed by the police out of nowhere with these crazy circumstances, it's totally the opposite. It's, well, oh, yeah, you know, it happens, whatever.
You know how they say, one bad apple spoils the bunch. If you want to look at the statistics of what the government is propagating on the FBI's website, 51 law enforcement officers were killed feloniously in the line of duty last year, 2014. Now, this is an increase of 89% when you compare it to the number in 2013, when only 27 officers were killed.
What was the, I'm sorry, what was the in 2014?
2014, we've seen 51 law enforcement officers felonously killed.
What does that exactly mean, though? Because I from what I saw, that was not that they were murdered.
The FBI compiles information from all the local jurisdiction police departments, the, you know, your hometown police department, and compiles the data. And there was, from the people who report, you know, there might be here a couple law police stations that are here and there that don't report back to the FBI, but I'd say at least 98-99% of them do. And there was a total report of only 51 law enforcement officers that were killed felonously, which I would assume means that they were, you know, maliciously gunned down.
See, I don't think it does, to be honest. You could be right, but the other thing that I had noticed, because I went through, and I don't remember what the total number was, but there was an article or a document that actually listed every single person that was killed, or every single police officer that was killed. And about 10 of them were in Puerto Rico. Now, I'm not saying that, you know, we don't care about officers in Puerto Rico, but it seems like Puerto Rico has a high amount of officers that are killed, but they're sure to throw those in. So anything that they can do to inflate those numbers, they do it.
Well, even if it's inflated, if you look at the flip side of it, of how many people that are supposed to be being protected by these people, just this year alone, since January 1st, there's been 446 deaths that we know of, and we can reference sources to local newspapers that reported on the death. No matter, you know, however the officer came to desiring to end this person's life, 446 people this year alone. And when you compare that to last year's number, 1,100 people killed by police.
So going back to, and I had read the article as well, but I didn't recall the specifics. How does this alert system, from how you understand it exactly, how does it work?
Well, I'm assuming it's probably going to be like the Amber Alert program, where the officers would probably,
like, they take over your fucking phone and say, oh, somebody's missing.
Well, hopefully they don't send it out to everybody, you know, that is on a national basis. But, you know, if you're connected to the phone line and you're connected to AT&T, Comcast, outside of probably IP providers of telephone service. But if you've got a landline, it's not hard for them to take, you know, send reports to you, and they'll probably gear it towards just people who are law enforcement or people that go and sign up for the program, and they have their websites that, you know, they get assigned login information, and that's specific to them. But that's how I would assume it would work. I don't think anybody has came out actually for the system and said, you know, that represents the government and how they're doing this, and said that this is exactly how it's going to work.
But I think, again, one of the important things that it just goes over people's heads, they don't think about it. whether they care or not, or they're just totally brainwashed, that why is it not the same way when you have so many more people getting killed by police for even worse circumstances, under worse circumstances? And they're basically saying, and I wish somebody would come out and say this, and I mean, they have an independent media, but cops' lives are, you know, 1,000 times more important than anybody else's. And I've said this before, if cops are supposedly there, which we know this is not why they're there, but if they're supposedly there to protect people, and their lives are more important than the people they're trying to protect, then what is the fucking point? And there is not one. And I don't know how this became so fucking just taboo, or you can't, you know, politicians or whatever, you can't even say anything about it. I mean, how many politicians even come out and really, you know, say anything outside of maybe you'll get some local city council people if you're lucky, or a mayor? Even the mayor in Baltimore, it was, you know, even if you look at the things that she had said, and they told, and this is even more fucked up because the media totally blew it out of proportion. Like, oh my God, I can't believe she said this. And I'm like, well, what the fuck did she even say? That, you know, and nobody's coming out and telling the truth or being honest, or you know, with all the things that are fucked up about not just the U.S., but every country, because every country has a government. I mean, the insanity.
We're all being brainwashed.
Well, it really is nuts. It really is insane when you think about some of these fucking things. And it's, hey, one or two cops get killed, they get targeted. Oh my God, it's the end of the world. We need to do this, we need to do that, we need to do whatever. You know, 1,000 regular people, because I don't use the word citizen, because what is that anyway? That's, well, you know, they probably deserved it. They probably, you know. So it's, how fucking crazy is this really when you look at it? And this whole thing, and Larkin Rose does a really good job when he talks about stuff like this. But, and we'll talk about this later in the show, because this is something that I really do want to get into when it comes to self-defense. But because somebody's a government agent or a cop or whatever, suddenly they're able to do whatever they want to you, and it's okay. And you don't have any right to defend yourself, or you don't have any right to stop them from, you know, beating you to death or whatever. And if you do, they'll charge you with assault. But it's not like assault, like you're in a fight with a regular person. It's like they have some kind of king status there, where, well, you assaulted a police officer, so that makes you a bad person. Really? Because, you know, a police officer is trying to kill me and I tried to save my life, I'm a fucking bad person? It's just, it's really, you know, and I don't think this is something that I've said before, although I've probably thought it, but it's like people are mentally ill. It's totally nuts.
The people have been systematically, over a long period of time, convinced that the majority of a minority of specific and elite individuals have the authority simply because you were told they have this authority and you must obey. And to do otherwise is just wrong, because they said so. That's authority. Now, I understand giving authority to people who earn it. Respect is given. You know, respect is earned, not given.
But wait, when you say authority, and think about this for a second. So, really, what authority can anybody have, and what authority? So, and I'm not explaining this the right way, but it's how can somebody give authority to somebody else that they don't have the authority in the first place to give? So that's like saying, you know, whatever, I'm the mayor or I'm whatever I am of this fucking town. And I tell the police, hey, you can arrest these people and lock them up and put them in jail. And of course, you notice how they use all these words that make it sound nice. And it's all the same, you know, shit that they use when for political campaigns. And what's the best way to propagandize something and get people to accept it and all that. Instead of saying what they're really doing is they're fucking kidnapping people and locking them up in cages. That's really what they're doing. But looking at something like drugs, who has the authority to tell anybody else anyway that you have this authority to go kidnap this person if they do drugs? Because it's creating authorities that you don't have in the first place. So what I'm saying is people are saying that under what authority? Well, the United States government. Well, what authority does the United States government have in the first place to allow all of these things?
That's what they'll tell you.
Well, they don't is the whole point, that they don't have authority. They have guns in force. They have enough people to say, look, where's your authority come from? And they can say, well, the people, they'll tell you all this bullshit. The people voted us in. The people did this. The people did that. No, you have enough fucking idiots
of a minority.
Well, you have enough fucking idiots that obey you and have guns and all these other weapons that will stop people or kidnap them or whatever. That's what your authority is. You have no actual real quote-unquote authority over anybody.
No, it's and like I said, you have authority over an individual who's given you authority over them, and you have the illusion that simply because they were here first, or the fact that, like I've been saying, that a majority of a minority of people have chosen these people as your masters, whether you participate in the system or not, you will comply, or we will convince everybody on the media, because we own the media, we control the media, that you are a bad person and deserve to die because you were against government.
And yeah, but it goes beyond that. It really does. I mean,
that's only one aspect of a big, you know, multi-connected
chain. Right. But there's no difference between a gang and the government. They somehow, by having elections, they're able to get a certain amount of people to actually say, well, we get to vote. So that's not true. It's not like a gang, because we get to vote and they're able to convince people that somehow they have say when they really don't. But
and they convince people that if you don't vote, then you have no right to complain. But what that makes no sense at all.
Yeah,
that has
I mean,
no logic. If you vote, you chose this shit. Yeah, I have every right to complain because I didn't want nothing to do with it.
That's just an asinine statement used for the same reason, for propaganda. And it's whatever. They can say whatever bullshit. And I think, you know, less and less people actually believe that bullshit anyway. They really do, because it makes no sense anyway. I mean, even to say that, well, if you don't vote, you can't complain. Well, what happens if, you know, is it if your person wins, you know, can you complain? Because, hey, you voted for that person, so shouldn't you not be able to complain? Shouldn't it be if your person loses? I mean, it's all of this fucking propaganda and brainwashing. And I was talking about, I don't know if it was last night or the night before, but just how you have all these focus groups, you have all these consultants and all of these things that work on campaigns, and they test, you know, they gather like focus groups. They do it with movies and stuff too. And, you know, they get feedback and how does this line work? How does this, you know, what do you think of when somebody says this and all of these things? And my whole, you know, premise regarding that is that they do that with everything. You know, all of this shit that they want to accomplish, they have an agenda and they think about what's the best way to present this and to present that and to convince people and brainwash people into what it is. And it's really, I mean, it was fucked up from the start, because, again, when you have a government forcing itself on people, and that's what it is, you cannot have a government without it forcing itself on people without consent. But when you have that, you don't have freedom anyway. But the level that things have gotten to, because, again, it just progressively gets worse and worse, although you can go back through history and find some pretty fucking bad things. But it's, you know, I've been talking about this kind of the last couple of nights, where sometimes it's like, you know, it's like, what the fuck is left to do? What do you even do at this point? So, again, we'll get into more of that a little later in the show. I don't want to kind of continue all these rants right now, but what else is going on in the police state of Nazis?
Well, how would you feel if you had to rush your child to the emergency room because they were turning blue and they weren't breathing, and the doctor who was supposed to come and save your child's life was pulled over by the police and detained for over 15 minutes?
Well, if you just go to the first part and said that they were turning blue, I may think that they were injected with a Smurf serum. But after that part, you eat a blueberry. I don't know if you'd seen the first Willy Wonka movie with Gene Wilder, where she ate one of these, I think it was like an everlasting gobstopper or something, and at the end she turned into a blueberry, but that's a whole nother thing. So
Violet's turning violet.
Right. So the doctor got pulled over and they died, or what happened?
Well, Dr. Bang is the man.
Is that really the guy's name?
Yes.
You know that guy went through a lot of shit. How do you spell it?
B-A-N-G.
It's just like regular, like, Bang. You know, because sometimes you have like maybe a different culture. It's spelled like a different, you know, a different way or whatever.
Well, I'm not sure exactly how to pronounce his first name, because I'm not sure of his ethnicity, his background, where he's from.
But Dr. Bang.
Bang.
He probably used that shit, too. Like, that's right, I'm Dr. Bang, motherfucker. I'm banging everybody. But go ahead.
Well, he received a call about a baby who had stopped breathing at the regional hospital he was staffed at. Now, many people know that only a few minutes without air can cause life-altering brain damage or even death. Now, Dr. Bang had been pulled over by police several times before when he was rushing to answer emergency calls. So the police had initially gave him a specific route to take any time he had to rush to the hospital, and was informed to call 911 on his way. Now, although he followed these exact instructions, he still ended up being pulled over. The police detained him after explaining the situation. Still detained him after even explaining the situation for approximately 15 minutes before letting him go, charging him with reckless driving. The child does later die, and many people are toting it up as possibly due to the traffic stop the doctor was subjected to. And even to top it all off, the municipal court has decided that Dr. Bang was guilty and now faces losing his driver's license.
Guilty of what?
Reckless driving and other charges.
But wait, so what was he doing that was reckless? Just speeding?
He was driving up towards of 140 mile an hour on a four-lane highway.
What's the... Did it say what the speed limit was? The regular... Not that that means anything.
Well, it's probably, you know, anywhere from 65, 70, 80.
But I mean, if it's a freeway and it's a four-lane free... I don't know, whatever.
Well, it might have been more four-way. I can go check it, but it was a large highway and...
Yeah, still, I mean, it's not like he's driving down, like, just, you know, the... a residential road or something, so...
But see, you have a situation where the government has set out a route that they told him that he was supposed to take that was, you know they're bidding, and he was following their orders, and even though he was doing exactly what they told him to, he still got to pay him for doing his job. And then on top of that, he's got to turn around and pay taxes on the money that he earns for trying to save that baby's life.
Yeah, it's crazy because, right, they'll say, well, do this, but then you do that, and well, we changed our mind, I guess. Yeah, it doesn't matter. And that, you know, along with a whole bunch of other points, but they can do whatever the fuck they want to do. And I don't know why some people, it just doesn't get through their head, because there's so many examples of it. But the government can do whatever they want to do. The fact is, and we've talked about this before, if they want to kill you, what?
I said you got a lot of people out there that, you know, they're headstrong and they're like, that ain't ever going to happen to me. That ain't ever going to happen around.
And hopefully it won't. But it doesn't mean it can't. That's the difference. Where, and I keep talking about this fucking idiot who talked about, well, we don't live in a police state because you can do your show. But bottom line is that, and that's just because of the illusion. If the government can kill anybody they want for no reason, you know, and they can do all these other things to people, just because they don't do it to every single person doesn't mean that it's not a police state. The fact that they can do it, you know, like if you take an example of, okay, somebody's a dictator and say... say you're the dictator, because I don't want to be the dictator. So you're the dictator.
I'm the dictator.
You're Dictator Woody. That just sounds wrong in itself. But so, you know, a couple people pissed you off, so you killed them. But, you know, you only killed maybe two or three people. But you just killed them because you felt like it. And you had no reason, and nothing happened, because you can kill people if you want to. Now, does the fact that you didn't kill everybody else, does it make a difference? Does that mean that you don't have any less power, or that you're not in a police state just because you just didn't choose to kill those people?
If I've got more pawns than you, you damn right it does.
So, I mean, the point being that... if you live in a, or you're under some tyrannical government, which I think, you know, all governments are tyrannical, but I think that's just, hence, that's what governments are. But this whole notion that just because it doesn't happen to everybody and some people are able to... luckily get through life without things like this happening to them. You also got to remember that there's over 300 million people in the country too. So it makes it a lot harder the more people there are. But at the same time, they're building all this infrastructure. So I know we kind of got off on a whole totally different thing here. But so bottom line, what happened? I wanted to call him Mr. Tang, like the fucking drink. But Dr. Bang. So what was the end result of what happened with Dr. Bang?
Well, as far as I know that he's currently to go back to court and be sentenced, because you know how they like to drag out the whole court thing. But he's supposed to be facing the possibility of losing this driver's license, whatever a driver's license is, for 6 months. And apparently it's a big deal.
He's going to lose his driver's license for 6 months because of... And it was just a speeding, right? Did I not...
He drove 140 mile an hour down the highway he was told to drive.
Right.
To try to save a little infant's life.
Because I was like, am I missing something? I mean, did he run a bunch of people over in the process?
No.
I mean, so...
He didn't hurt anybody. He actually failed to save a child's life. You know, this family was relying on this doctor to be here and do his job. You know, that's what this man's paid for, and that's what he desired to do. And because of the police, this child's probably dead. Well, the child is dead, and it's probably because of the police.
Yeah, but of course.
They wanted to stop him for over 15 minutes.
They're
doing exactly what they told him to do.
They're not going to be held accountable because they are able to do whatever they want because they're part of the government. So the government, unless when they, you know, want to kind of throw somebody out there to use as an example or to try to show, hey, look, we're doing something, you know, and
somebody's got to be thrown under the bus,
you know, exactly. And people use that. What's so funny about it, you would think most people, unless they're morons, that, you know, they're not going to fall for that bullshit. Like, oh, yeah, just because, you know, these couple people were actually held accountable, that, you know, what does that mean? But you literally have, but hold on, but you literally have people that do say, oh, look, well, they were held accountable. See, there's justice.
One in a million. But still, you got people out there that see this thing that they call law. Now, in my personal opinion, I define law and, you know, legal and lawful in two completely different terms. And what they operate under is lawfulness, which is
that
made
an actual
by other
word?
People. It's arbitrary. It's arbitrary
lawfulness.
Writings, arbitrary writings that are written in fancy little ways, with a bunch of people signing it in fancy little fucking cursive and putting their names at the bottom of this. And you have to follow it, no questions asked, or you do not pass go, you do not collect $200. And we have laws in Missouri.
You know, I think that has to be updated, because that $200 doesn't really go that far anymore with, you know, the way they've pretty much destroyed the currency. But go ahead.
We have laws that are set in place to where a law enforcement officer here in Missouri, in effecting an arrest or preventing an escape from custody, is justified in using deadly force when such is authorized under other sections of this chapter, or when he reasonably believes that such use of deadly force is immediately necessary to effect the arrest, and also reasonably believes that the person is to be arrested. He also or has committed or attempted to commit a felony. So if the officer observes you committing a felony or has a warrant for your arrest based on a felony, he can kill you if you try to run or resist. Or you are attempting to escape by use of a deadly weapon, or may otherwise endanger life or inflict serious physical injury unless arrested without delay. Now, if you fuck up and you get killed, the defendant shall have the burden of justification. Not the officer, He doesn't have to justify why he killed you. You have to justify why you're dead.
Yeah, that's pretty hard to do if you're dead. That's why most of the time they want to make sure that people don't survive, because then there's no witnesses there. But we're going to take a quick break. When we come back, we'll talk more about some of the stories that have been going on in the past few weeks in the Nazi police state, or again, I got to come up with a better saying for that. Later in the show, we're going to talk about...
It's a work in progress.
Right. Later in the show, we're going to talk about both the military and the police and the differences, if any. So we will talk all about that and more, and we'll be back right after this. Nonpartisan Liberty for All, nonpartisanlibertyforall.com.
There is breaking news in Baltimore, where on the same day Obama administration officials met with the mayor, Charm City appears to be turning into the Wild West. Nearly two dozen people shot over the last 24 hours, and sources inside the Baltimore PD telling the Kelly File, this is not getting better anytime soon. Welcome to the Kelly File, everyone. I'm Megyn Kelly. We have three major developments tonight on the mess in Baltimore. The head of the DOJ Civil Rights Division making some controversial remarks involving cops and a history of racism. The Baltimore prosecutor, seeing her case against three of the officers begin to crumble, is now changing her story, and all in a city where crime is now exploding. In the last month, since charges were filed against six police officers for the death of a 25-year-old black man, Freddie Gray, homicides in Baltimore have spiked 40% compared to the same period last year. Non-fatal shootings are up 60%. The Western District of the city where the riots took place has seen 22 homicides in just the last 4 months. That's more than the entirety of last year. And just today, five more people were shot in a broad daylight gun battle ranging over a half mile down residential streets. All of this happens as arrests are now down by 32%. And police reps say the rank and file feel alienated by this prosecutor and are concerned about doing their jobs. Mark Furman is a Fox News contributor and a former LAPD homicide detective. Mark, it's good to see you. And so the mayor comes out and says, no, this isn't the case. The cops are not holding back. And the police officially came out and said, no, they're not. They're not. And yet these numbers seem to tell a different story.
Well, Megyn, they're not holding back. What they're doing is being very... cautious about following all the rules. They know that nobody's got their back in the city government. Their own police chief's going to throw them under the bus. So they're doing everything by the book. They're answering the radio calls and they're making no proactive stops. They're not getting out and shaking people down, wondering what people are doing, searching people, looking for guns, drugs. They're basically just answering the calls to service, making sure nobody gets killed and taking care of their fellow officers. And this is exactly what the city government gets. They're going to get a police department that answers the cat in the tree call, and that's it.
We have a police department that does not believe its commissioner has stood by it. We've heard that directly from the cops. The mayor threw them under the bus. The mayor invited the DOJ to come and investigate an alleged presence of discrimination and racism. The DOJ was only too happy to do it, and we'll talk in our next blocks about what the DOJ said about Baltimore cops today. And on top of all that, the NAACP steps in to stoke the fires. And in an editorial in the Baltimore Sun today, they outline how they believe the NAACP accused the cops of being, quote, borderline racist. And let me show the viewers and you, Mark, what the NAACP writes to the cops representative. They say, we were disturbed by your use of language describing these frustrated young citizens as a lynch mob, referring to the rioters. You, police representative, then decided to defend those six officers by all but attacking DA Marilyn Mosby, a young African-American mother of two. And it bothers us greatly to have the integrity of these strong African-American female leaders questioned by someone who is pushing a personal agenda in the face of clear injustice. This is the cop representative, they say, is doing that, regardless of the possible irreparable harm it may have on our city. So the cop rep should not fight back because the mayor and the DA are African-American females.
Well, Megan, when you look at this, Mosby made a statement that this is our time when she indicted those six officers. She drew a line in the sand, and she drew a wedge between the police, the city government, and her office that you're never going to repair. They're not going to be able to go back on this, and the police are going to simply do what the police do. They're going to take care of their own. They're going to take care of those good citizens that are in trouble. And you can't do anything about what you don't see. If you're not there to see it, you're not there to see it. And there is no city official that can control an officer and his partner when they get on that car. When they get that in that car, the world is theirs. What they decide to do and what they decide not to do is up to them, not their sergeant, lieutenant, their chief, the mayor, or the city councilman.
They now need to worry, potentially, about making a mistake and getting charged with false arrest, false imprisonment, and the loss of their freedom. How does this end? Because we're already hearing from some of our Baltimore police officer sources that they're looking to leave this police force.
Well, that's what's going to happen. The only people you're going to have left are the people that are either going to do nothing and just agree with the administration, or they're going to leave the department. Officers are going to actually find better places to go that actually have respect for them and actually back them when they actually do lawful arrests and make, you know, lawful, actually do their job. But, Megan, you have to see what's going on here. You have two dynamics. You have the city administration and every government official in Baltimore trying to get police scalps. They're not throwing them under the bus. They're trying to get scalps. Now, while that's going on, all the gang members, all the drug dealers, all the two-bit criminals, all the wannabes, it's vacation. They know they'll be able to take advantage of the police not wanting to be in the area because they are the target of these gang members and all these drug dealers. So they're also the target of their own administration. So they're going to pull back, they're going to do their job, and they're going to stay out of trouble.
Wow. Meantime, this DA, she sits down with Vogue magazine for a profile interview while the city is awash in homicides that she should be pursuing. Mark, thank you.
Ja'Kari Jackson here, out here in Cleveland, Ohio, right outside the Cavalier Stadium. You guys can see that. And of course, the reason we're here, Officer Brillo, with all the high profile cases of questionable police actions in the country over the past, I guess just the past year, it's kind of fell under the radar, but people here in Cleveland haven't forgot. So Officer Brillo, for those who don't know, is facing some very serious charges for an incident that happened back in 2012. Where he, as well as many other officers, were in pursuit of some suspects. And Officer Brillo took it upon himself to actually jump on the hood of the car the suspects were in, fired multiple rounds, and is now being charged with manslaughter. You know, many people are questioning, is it going to stay manslaughter? Is it going to be something lesser, something worse? We really don't know. They came out today and announced on the news that they're not expecting a verdict until tomorrow at the earliest. So we'll be out here to document what happens. And I'm very happy to say, you can see what's going on out here. That's the Cleveland Indian Stadium, Progressive Field, right across the street. It's very quiet out here. I'm just out here shooting my selfie video. No National Guard on the street corners. No riots, no looting, so it's a very calm atmosphere. And I hope it stays that way, because right now the Cavaliers are getting ready to go to the playoffs. I believe their first game is on Wednesday. So it's a nice, quiet atmosphere, and we'll be out here to document whatever happens, but hopefully, you know, things stay just like they are now. But it brings to mind an article I saw earlier today. Actually, let me pull out my phone so I can reference it properly. Basically, the White House came out and was talking about militarized police. You know, that's something I talk about quite a bit as well. But here's the article out of Newsweek. White House proposes limits on use of military equipment by police. Which, on the surface, if I was somebody who's halfway paying attention, I'd praise them. Like, yeah, that's a good idea. Great job, White House. But the issue these guys have been getting the military equipment from the Pentagon. So when you hear the Justice Department get on TV and talk about we need to federalize the police, if you think federalizing the police is somehow going to get rid of all these MRAPs and grenade launchers and all this other stuff that these guys have, I got some oceanfront property back in Oklahoma, and from my front porch you can see the sea. That's not going to happen. And while I definitely do agree that changes need to be made, you need to make real change. Example, stop giving these guys these MRAPs and grenade launchers. Now, my understanding is what the White House is proposing would stop federal grants and stuff like that, not so much what these guys go out and buy privately. But, you know, hopefully that would be something for the better. Like I said, if they didn't want these guys to have it, they shouldn't have gave it to them in the first place. And they sell this stuff to these guys at dirt cheap prices, you know, rock bottom. These guys can get a brand new MRAP or Bearcat cheaper than you and I can go out and buy a used minivan. This shows you how they get the stuff. This is the Indian Stadium right here. So we'll be out here to document, at least for the next few days, see what happens. Like I said, hopefully it stays just like this, nice and quiet. Well, it'll get a little rowdier later in the week when the Cavaliers start playing in the playoffs, but hopefully no drama, no issues, and hopefully the country can learn from the mistakes of the past and begin to build a better future. You guys can find more reports on the Alex Jones channel on YouTube.
You are listening to Nonpartisan Liberty for All Radio with your host, Dave Bourne.
Nonpartisan Liberty for All, and we are back. During the break, sorry, I was just trying to swallow there. During the break, there was a clip from Fox News from the Kelly File, which I don't even know why she has a show. And I don't want to sound sexist, but probably part of it is looks-wise. But anyway, not that she's not intelligent, because I guess she is. I don't know. Whatever. But some of the stuff that came out of that they were talking about is just the way that they're taking the side of the police and basically saying, well, if you do anything to, you know, stop the police's ability to just murder people or abuse people, you know, all the police are going to quit and there's going to be all this crime, and somehow people buy into this fucking shit. And Thomas, I don't know if you had a chance to hear any of that report.
I heard it.
But I mean, that's just in general something that we hear all the time, though. It's, well, you can't do this because, well, you know, the police aren't going to be able to stop crime. Somehow, in people's minds, police need to be able to do whatever they need to do, whether it's kill people or just, you know, break down your door or whatever they need to do. Or whatever they claim they need to do. If they're not able to do that, that all of a sudden means, oh my God, the whole city's going to be overrun by criminals.
Well, you can't let the system collapse, you know. That's the thinking that they have. But I don't understand. Because for me, I'm not scared of the Obama. I'm not scared of the Hitlers. I'm not scared of the Maos or Stalins. I'm not scared of the dictators. I'm scared of the thousands of people as they get to mindlessly follow them. And if police want to complain that they can't do their job because they're scared to do their jobs, they're obviously doing it wrong. Or the entire United States of America is just one big ass mean criminal, which I can't swallow that for a minute. I can't logically think that every person I meet on the street corner is going to try to harm me in one way or another.
Well, bottom line, I mean, pretty much, and they're probably always like this, but I can't really speak to police that were around before I was. But for the most part, they're a bunch of fucking pussies is really what it is. Well, they're bullies as well. And usually bullies are, that's what they are. I mean, they bully people because of their own insecurities. And that's what they are. And they're all about themselves, their own, you know, protecting themselves. And they're the ones who are scared. And if they are, you know, as you said, they shouldn't be in that industry. I mean, first of all, as I've said before, I don't believe that government police should exist, which, of course, is one of the main premises of the show. But it's, you know, the more and more you hear, it's just you keep thinking that it can't get any crazier as far as some of the things that people are saying. And it just continues to just get crazier and crazier. But so what else is going on in the police state?
Well, if officers are so afraid to do their job, they need to get another job, just like these officers that were involved in a SWAT raid. Now, this was over a year ago, but there's updates to it. Now, nearly a year has passed since a SWAT team stormed into a residence and nearly killed a 19-month-old child that we all know today as Boo Boo, I believe it has.
Is that the one in Georgia with the flashbang grenade?
Where they threw the flashbang grenade into the child's crib. Now, to any sane person, clearly the sheriff's department would be responsible for the damages inflicted on this child, correct? But even though the SWAT team invaded the home on the basis of a bogus anonymous tip about a $50 drug transaction that allegedly occurred but didn't, his parents and his siblings are said to be fully and exclusively to blame for the injuries that nearly killed the child and left the family with more than $1 million in medical bills in a response that was filed by the police union lawyer. Furthermore, the actions of the police are being touted as being legally blameless. So you cannot sue the individuals because they were acting under the color of law.
Well, that's where, you know, that same whole thing where they'll say that you assaulted a police officer because when they punched you in the face, they hurt their fist.
And you fought back. You defended yourself.
Well, I'm even saying when you don't defend yourself and they just punch you and they say, well, your head hit my fist, even though I punched you in your head, but you're responsible. You assaulted my fist.
Yeah, but the ones that don't die when they're beat up by the cops, lots of them, more than not, I would say, always come back, you know, with the response, well, imagine if I would have defended myself and fought back. You probably wouldn't be here, buddy.
Yeah, that's where they would probably be dead. So, And I'm sorry. With that story, it was the update was what? That the they're not able to file any lawsuits, or the lawsuits were dismissed, or what? What was, I guess, the main?
The family had sued the city, because you can't sue the police department. Apparently, you can't sue the individuals, you know, that are responsible for what they done. So they sued the city. And like I said, you know how court proceedings are. They like to take their sweet ass time and drag shit out. This has got to the point to where they have filed a complaint with the court, and the police union lawyer has filed a response. And the response is that these officers are legally blameless. And if you read the response, it just pisses you off, because if you know the situation, you know what happened, what what all led up to this.
Yeah,
apparently the family had been
for people
selling meth or something.
But for people that don't know, just briefly go through what had happened there, because you know that this baby is now disfigured for the rest of his life. But
this baby's tore up.
Just briefly go through what had happened there.
A snitch for the police department had gave an anonymous tip. So I'm not even sure if they, you know, they didn't even know who it was, because you see lots of times nowadays where people would just call these hotlines and just report whatever, and that cops act on it. But an anonymous tip was made that a $50 drug
isn't that what happened to you as well?
It's happened to me actually a couple times. So the cops will act on it, and specifically where I'm at, I guarantee you, if they don't like you, they're going to act on it. Now, a $50 drug transaction, allegedly the transfer of methamphetamines, and your methamphetamines are so bad, even though it's a Schedule II drug, meaning it's not even illegal, it's just controlled, and you can get this from your doctor prescribed to you, look up Desoxin, because they allegedly had bought or sold $50 worth of methamphetamine, they took heavily armed men, a group of men, not one or two. They didn't come and knock and ask, you know, if this happened or introduce a search warrant. They took a squad of men, several people, fully armed to the teeth with assault weapons.
Yeah, it was a whole fucking SWAT weapons, team and shit.
And invaded their home. And in the process of invading their home, they had threw what they call a noise distraction device. Pretty much, I'm probably not saying that exactly correct, but a flashbang grenade essentially that's designed to disorient and distract the target. Now, this flashbang didn't exactly go onto the floor or happen to end up in the sink. It ended up in the crib of a 19-month-old child and exploded. These things are explosives, small explosives compared to what a grenade would have been, but still an explosive that gives off high amounts of heat to produce high intensity flashes of light to disorient you and temporarily blind you. And this went off on this child's chest, right next to him. Either it was either on him or next to him in the crib, but either one is unacceptable. And this kid is permanently disfigured. And his parents are being told that they owe $1 million in medical bills. And the cops who done it in the city that employed him, in the majority of the minority that gave the SWAT team the authority, is saying they're not going to fucking pay for it. They don't have to legally, because they are blameless for acting under the color of law.
Well, it's all, you know, they say they just follow orders as well, so they don't feel responsible. Well, we're just following
Nazis
orders.
Did too.
And then, you know, there was an interview I had heard this morning. I think it was Glenn Beck or something. When I was driving to work, and there's of course this guy on who's defending, you know, oh yeah, all these drugs should be illegal and all this stuff. And somebody had brought that up about the flashbang grenade and all of the SWAT teams doing all this stuff. And he's like, well, that's not the fault of the law. That's just, you know, the procedures that they use.
It is the fault of the law. And the people who write the laws and claim that they have authority over everybody.
What about the fact that, and this is the thing, another thing that people just still don't get, that, you know, earlier I mentioned authority and the government technically not having authority over anything. They just have a bunch of people with guns. But the bottom line being that what right do any of these bureaucrats have to tell you that, well, if you possess this plant or you put this in your body, we're going to, you know, kidnap you and lock you up in a cage and we're going to send a SWAT team to your house and all of this shit. I mean, what has to happen for people to fucking wake up and get a it's crazy.
They're gonna have to experience it firsthand. I believe I experienced it firsthand more than once, and I didn't understand lots of times why they were doing what they were doing to me. And then you realize these motherfuckers are going to do what they want, when they want, how they want, and you're going to pay them. And if you don't, they're going to do what they want, when they want, how they want, and you're going to end up in a cage. And have fun in jail, buddy. Have fun in prison. Hey, if that crazy-ass motherfucker you're locked up with doesn't like you and wants to fuck you in the ass, good luck.
I mean, I personally think that every single cop, although I don't think they should exist, but let's just say for the sake of argument that they should spend 2 weeks in jail without anybody knowing who they are. And then, you know, maybe they'll think twice when, you know, they're arresting people for victimless crimes.
No victim, no crime. It's as simple as that. If I haven't hurt anybody, and simply because I didn't pay you for something you have allegedly you did for me when you have done nothing, and you want to claim that because the people that were here before me have built what we have around us, that you deserve something? No.
I mean, I think about, and I think it was Tuesday night when I had Ken Shorjan on of the Daily Economist. He had brought up V for Vendetta in one of the scenes in there. But one of the scenes that I had just thought of, you know, when thinking about peaceful revolutions and changing things, where at the end, everybody got together and essentially, you know, they had the military with guns and they just said, fuck it. And they just kept advancing and they stood down.
If you really want to defeat the system, the best way, just do not consent. Don't do what they tell you. You don't have to. They have no authority that you do not give them.
Well, that's yes and no, because part of that, I mean, yes, that is true. But on the other side of that,
it's the basis of the whole system that they have built their freaking empire around. So if they want to tell me that they're going to adhere to this basis that they've built their shit around, and I'm not stupid. You can't tell me you're going to sell me apples and then fucking give me plums. I know what a fucking plum is. I know what a damn apple is. One of these things is not like the other. You're not going to tell me that you're going to do this for me and this for me and this for me, and in fact, you don't do a damn thing. Why do I got to do anything for you? Why do I have to pay you to go around and harm people?
Well, what I'm saying, though, is if you're you being anybody, you know, when it's one or two people standing there, it's a lot harder to make a difference. When you have 10,000 people standing there, and that's where I think of, you know, the scene from V from Vendetta, where you have probably hundreds of thousands. And what are they going to do? Kill everybody? You know, the same thing. They're going to arrest everybody. But
they make us all think that, you know, that we're the only ones that think this way, that we're the only ones that are tired of it, and that their gang is bigger than our gang. You know, not to call that we have what we have as a gang, but to put it in layman terms, they have a bigger following than the individual that they're fighting against us. Therefore, you know, strength in numbers.
Well, that's definitely something, along, of course, with all their other tactics that they use, is that the government definitely uses the tactic of making people think that they're the only ones. And if you look at this, I mean, and we've talked about this before as well, that they don't even have to attack people themselves. Because they have other people that will do it for them. That's how fucked up people are.
And they'll do it simply because they were told to.
Well, not even necessarily because they're told to. They're brainwashed into thinking like, you know, well, why would you say that? Oh, you're un-American, or you hate America? It's the best country in the world, or whatever. And I mean, I guess you can say they're told to, but what I mean is that it's their whole, you know, brainwashing and conditioning and all of that shit.
The government has no interest in an informed population. They have no interest in an intelligent population. Intelligent people don't bow down. They don't mindlessly follow the rhetoric that's spoken, that's spilled out to them by people they don't even know. They just show up on the TV, show up on the radio, show up in, you know, the towns they're residing in, and start making fancy speeches. People who are logical and actually think shit through can see through the lies, and they're not interested in people like that. So they have an interest in breeding a dumbed down generation, and they slowly dumb you down over the generations, make you dumber and dumber and dumber, and you're more easily to control and persuade. And then they teach you this, and they beat it into your head from day one for 18 years, well, 13 years, even longer in some cases.
It's ongoing. I mean, well, I guess it depends, you know, when you're saying 18 or 13, if you're talking about school or whatever, but it's your whole life. It's a continuous process where you're handed off from, you know, parents to school to government to whatever. But is there any more police state stories that you want to get to? And we can go through some of those and then move on to some of the other stuff regarding the police and the military.
Well, keeping on the topic of Detroit, members of the Detroit Fugitive Apprehensive Task Force said they wanted inside the house of Terrence Kellum. They told the father who resided there. Now, Terrence Kellum is the child of this man. The father is the one that answered the door. They told the father who resided there that if he refused to allow the police to enter the home, and they did not have a warrant, that they would simply break down the door. Now, when police did gain access to the home, which was given to them by the man because he was intimidated by the police, and a desire of not having his door broke down, and then potentially, you know, another criminal come by and take the opportunity to rob them, he allowed the police to come in. And the police immediately ran upstairs, located the man's son, and dragged him down the stairs, where they shot him in the chest and executed the child, the person. Now, the father says,
for what was he?
That's the exact words he used.
But was he even? What were they there for in the first place? Was he like wanted for a crime or something, or were they just? Did they just go after him?
Well, more likely than not. You know, people usually are wanted on what simple drug offenses, but this man had been wanted by a multi-jurisdictional task force on, I don't have it right down here in front of me, but Homeland Security is, excuse me, I'm trying to find right here in the report exactly what they wanted him for. But we got, you know, obvious government waste, because they have how many different departments of the military that are investigating this. Now, they got the Wayne County Prosecutor's Office, the Detroit Police Homicide Task Force, the Michigan State Police, and Homeland Security conducting investigations into whether this kid should have been shot or not. They had a right to kill this individual who was wanted on suspected robbery charges. Now, right, they don't even know that he had done it. He was simply suspected in connection with it, and they wanted to talk to him about it. So they show up at his house with a SWAT team and kill him.
So basically, they have a bunch of government agencies that all work together that are all part of the same team investigating themselves.
And this man was 20 years old. And this is what we see all the time. the same system, investigating the same system that they work for, that they perpetuate. And
so
it's ridiculous.
Why should, if the police show up at your fucking door without a warrant, and we can even debate, you know, if there is a warrant, because pretty much judges just sign them anyway. But let's just say, for the sake of argument, they show up at your door without a warrant. They threaten to say, they even admit, yeah, we don't have a warrant, but basically we don't give a fuck. We're going to break your door down, even though, you know, legally, and, you know, I don't even know how to really define that word, but legally we can't do this, but we're going to do it anyway. Why do you not have the right to say, if you start to break down my fucking door, I'm going to defend myself in my house?
Well, here's what the police are saying happened. They said when they went there to serve the warrant and arrest the 20-year-old, that Terrence Kellum was hiding in the attic, where when they came up the stairs, he then jumped out at them, swinging a hammer, where they felt justified in using automatic weapons and deadly force to stop a hammer-wielding 20-year-old. And there's 6-7 guys, and they can't stop.
Right, which happens all the time, and we all know how, you know, of course, police never lie or anything, which it's the same fucking story over and over again. A lot of times, they'll lie. They won't know there was a camera there. Then they'll have to change their story again. It's insane. And they can keep saying, well, we're going to get body cameras and we're not going to give them these tanks anymore, which, of course, is a bunch of bullshit. You know, we're going to federalize the police because, of course, the federal government, you know, aren't the ones that are training them to do all this shit or anything. Nothing is going to change. As long as you have these agencies or whatever you want to call them with this power to be able to do whatever they want, nothing's going to change. And that involves, and that's my whole point. And that's where, you know, I guess different people have strategies and how they want to accomplish stuff. So somebody will say, okay, well, ultimately, say they ultimately want to get rid of the police altogether and have a private type industry, but they'll talk about, you know, well, let's get cameras, let's do this, let's do that, because they want to slowly expose people to different things and try to convince them that way. And I don't have that, I guess, kind of agenda there where I'm just going to come out and say how I think things should be, how fucked up they are, and why they're fucked up. You know, and of course, yes, that's based on my opinion, but it's the truth.
And
it's just going to keep going through all this bullshit. Bottom line is, whether it's police, whether it's some fucking agency, or whether it's, you know, the government as a whole, when you give power, or this is not a hard concept to grasp, when you give power to a certain group of people over others, they can get away with whatever the fuck they want to get away with. And somehow, people do not grasp that.
They want to keep trying to figure out ways of stopping officers from doing this. I'll tell you how to stop it. Stop doing it altogether. Stop putting a Band-Aid on something that requires stitches. At first, do no harm. If it's not good for one person, it's not good for anybody. The best part about a good ideas don't require force. What's one thing you can think of that lots of people toed up about being, you know, good things to do because, you know, when they're out there going back and forth to work, they don't want to be subject to somebody who's irresponsible and inebriates himself and goes out and try to drive their vehicle. You know, they want to do all these checkpoints. You know what I'm talking about?
Yeah. Well, that's now, pre-crime is really what it is. But
exactly. But you're assumed guilty until proven innocent, not innocent until proven guilty, like they want to tell you. Now,
well, it's more like assumed a threat, like everybody's a threat.
Exactly. Now, a Lino Lakes police officer pulled a driver over for speeding as part of a multi-agency traffic enforcement detail. Now, this is a little bit different than the, you know, this is where they set up the checkpoints. But what they do, it's a little more intuitive, I guess you say. But they actually go out in force and set up in quote-unquote strategic locations and try to catch people doing anything and everything that they deem to be a violation of quote-unquote traffic laws. Now, the authorities are saying, you know, the police, the government, that the driver had outstanding warrants and was suspected of driving under the influence. That's the justification for what they did. Now, a struggle had ensued after Holmes, the man's name is Mr. Holmes, and he got out of his vehicle. So the officers tried to do him with a taser. All right, you know, that's a good thing that they went to a taser first. Lots of times we see them going directly, you know, for the deadly force and using their firearms, and they don't shoot once, they don't shoot twice, 4, 5, 6 times sometimes, even more. So the man, after being tased, you know, somebody tases you, Dave, you're going to be like, fuck this shit, get the hell out of here, right? So the man tries to get back in his vehicle and drive off. But the police officer who was trying to arrest him decides to hold on to the vehicle. So he then pulls out his firearm and shoots the driver, who then later crashes the vehicle and is found dead on the scene. Simply because he had outstanding warrants, which, you know, of course they're not going to tell you what the outstanding warrants are for unless it's something super serious, and was suspected of driving under the influence.
Well, you know, if you're suspected of something, the punishment for that is up to and including death.
You better believe it, people.
So, any other stories?
Well,
or basically,
Florida. Excuse me. In Florida, okay, the police tasered a man who then later died. Now, this is a very interesting report because of all the contradictive reports that are coming out about the incident, like we were talking about before. The account by a man who was with the victim does not agree with the one included in the original probable cause affidavit that was written by the arresting officer. Now, according to the officer's account, he took the man to the ground for repeatedly reaching into his waistband. But there's no mention of the victim being struck. He was never physically hit. So, but in a use of force report, one of the officers on scene, now this use of force report was written by a different officer. This officer admitted to hitting the victim multiple times with his flashlight. So he also left out details about the officer who used the taser. So we have one officer that said he used the taser, but didn't mention anything about the other officer beating the crap out of the man. Then the other officer says, yeah, I beat the crap out of the guy, but there's no tasers used.
Yeah, I don't know. It's just like the same shit over and over again. And, you know, sometimes you get to that point where it's like, what's left to fucking say about, well, you know,
if you
some
look
of this
at the
shit.
Tasers that they're using, they have chips inside of them, some little smart chips, you can say, but they actually report how many times that a taser has been used. And unless the officer is tech savvy, which, being that he is an officer, it might be unlikely that he is. Unless he's super tech savvy and can go in there and reprogram the information, or specifically trained on how to, which I would not find far fetched. the chip in the device, the taser device, actually showed that it had been used. And these devices supposedly cannot be altered. And it shows that the officer discharged the taser 3 times during the traffic stop. So according to the chronology of events report, an officer called for medical assistance after the man was tased, saying that is on police dispatch recordings, dispatch, start a rescue. He's complaining about an asthma attack. And approximately 30 seconds later, that ambulance was canceled when the officer radioed in saying, 6901, you can cancel rescue. He had a miraculous recovery. We see a taser discharged while the suspect was still in the vehicle en route to the jail prior to him jumping out, which perhaps explains why he jumped out. So the chronology of events is supposedly generated by a computer, so it's automatically generated from the information that's entered from other reports that are filed by supposedly separate officers. So you have a case where the report shows that a minute after the taser was deployed, the patrol car stopped. So the patrol car was in motion when the taser was initially used on the man. So you can see how the information that they're recovering from the incident, from the hardware information that they're getting from these smart chips that we have ordered the government to initiate so we can keep police accountable, is not adding up with 2 separate reports that were made by officers who are supposed to tell the entire events and all the events and nothing but the events. They don't add up. And the man that was with the guy who was tasered and subsequently died from the tasing, his report doesn't even add up with anything that they have.
Because I know, so it
who
doesn't,
the hell is telling the truth?
It doesn't matter, because they lie all the time. When they're found out that they lie, it doesn't make a fucking difference. It literally doesn't, because it happens all the time where they lie and things don't add up. They change the story a little. Oh, well, they're under pressure. They're this, they're that. And that's what happens.
Well, Dave, to top it all off, there is another witness who came forward and told the local news, quote, when he got out of the car, they started shoving him. They put the handcuffs on him and dropped him to the floor and started beating him up with the flashlights. And they were kicking him and stuff. There was like 6 people on top of him, and he was screaming for help, and the police never stopped. They never did. Unquote.
Well, he must have been lying, so, you know, that's what
they
would say.
Everybody's lying, right?
Right. If you're not a cop, then you're a liar. So I want to kind of get to what we were going to talk about regarding both the police and the military. But if you have any other stories, if you want to just go through them real quick, kind of the headlines briefly.
Well, I want to touch on something that I called into your show about before when I was simply just a little listener and I wasn't doing everything we're doing now. And I complained about an amendment that was made here in Missouri called the Right to Farm Act, which was in a proposed amendment to the Missouri Constitution that guaranteed people's right to farm in the state of Missouri. Now, I initially, you know, I called you up, and I don't know if you remember this or not, but I was not in support of it. I complained heavily against it because
I remembered something with pollution. Was that?
Kind of. I think I used that example as one. But the main thing I was getting at is the Right to Farm Act, if you look at it, can open up the possibility of foreign interests coming to Missouri, buying up land, and since they have a legal right to that land, they can do whatever they want to it as long as it is pertaining to farming. Of course, you know, within the confines of the list of things that you can do under the right to farm. But They can do whatever they want to the land, and nothing that no harm that comes out of it. They cannot be held liable for it. Just like how vaccine producers are not held liable for anything, any negative effects. If you have an allergic reaction or some other, you know, ill reaction to these vaccines that lots of people nowadays are being forced to take.
Well,
you cannot sue these people. You cannot sue because they have the right.
I was also worried about that law about, you know, the right to farm animals, where right. people could now, do whatever they wanted to farm animals. That was kind of concerning.
Now, some people would – lots of the religious would say this is a godsend, I guess you could say. But I'm actually surprised at how this law is being applied here in Missouri. The right to farm law, which is – constitutional, you know, it's in the Missouri Constitution, is you have the right to farm, is being applied to some individuals who are being charged with the cultivation of marijuana. Now, these men allegedly were growing marijuana. They were raided. Luckily, nobody died in this instance. And they are making the argument in the lovely legal system we have that under the right to farm law, that they can cultivate marijuana legally, and that marijuana prohibition in the state of Missouri is essentially unconstitutional because marijuana is medicine, and we know this for a fact that it's medicine. And they can't lie about it anymore. It's not addictive.
What would it even matter, the right to farm? You know, like, whether it's medicine or not, shouldn't they have the right to farm, you know, and grow marijuana and grow opium and grow, I don't know if opium would grow in Missouri, but, you know, coca leaves and all of that shit.
That's the exact point these individuals' lawyers are trying to make, is that because the right to farm law specifically states that if something is grown or cultivated that has medical use, as in marijuana... Marijuana does have medical uses. Just look it up.
So does opium.
Exactly. You cannot get in any sort of trouble whatsoever because you have the right to cultivate this product, this plant, because it has medical purposes.
Good. Let's start an opium farm in Missouri there.
There you go. And under the right to farm, you have that right in the state of Missouri. And that's the argument that's being made in the courts today. That
yeah,
they
but
had the right to cultivate marijuana.
But again, they can. It goes back to the same shit that they'll interpret the law any way they want and make up some bullshit reason as to why it doesn't apply.
But you know, you're absolutely right, and you see it a lot. You see it all the time. It's happened to me. I've had situations in my life where they got a warrant for the search of my home. My domicile, based on pure hearsay of somebody who was in trouble because he got caught with marijuana. And because he got caught with marijuana, he told the police that I had marijuana. And because I was more disliked than this individual, they let him go. And they get a warrant for my house. And when I challenged the warrant in court, because they had no right, they had no legal basis for this, no probable cause, I didn't even get to face my accusers. They wouldn't even bring him to court. They wouldn't allow me to subpoena him to any proceedings. So I couldn't talk to the man who accused me of having marijuana. I got to talk to the police in the state. And they said, simply because when they came into my house that they found marijuana, that right there is probable cause to believe that I was in possession of marijuana. So that is why the warrant was allowed to stand. So, you know, you're absolutely right that they're going to do what they want. Essentially. But when you have something that is clear-cut as this, and it's pretty publicized, and I want this out there, I want everybody to know about it because of this fact, that you have a law that clearly states that if this plant is cultivated, has medical use, and nobody's going to tell me marijuana does not have medical use. And what, you're going to tell me all the bad things about it? I guarantee you, you'll come up with a lot less of the bad things about marijuana than you will aspirin or you will ibuprofen.
No, definitely. But what I'm saying is opium, it's already used in all of these, you know,
consume the
stuff.
Most opium of all the people in the world. The United States population does.
Let people start doing it with opium and see what the government tries to do, because they can't argue that. And obviously marijuana has a lot of medical uses, but they try to use their bullshit, excuses as to why and whatever. They can't argue opium. So let people start growing opium and see what happens then.
The only recourse that I could see that the government would try for is a repeal. They would try to repeal the Constitution. Yeah,
probably.
Amendment. But constitutional amendments are supposed to be a lot harder to repeal than legal laws. Supposed to be. But we'll see. We will see. I'm going to keep a close eye on this, and I'm going to keep reporting back on it. But we're going to see what's going to happen.
All right. Well, let's take a break. When we come back, we will talk about the police and the military, and really what is even really the difference between the police and the military, as well as some of the things we started to talk about regarding self-defense. And Al Sharpton wants to federalize the police. Funny how he kind of just falls in with all of these other people that are trying to all of a sudden push an agenda there for the government. So we will talk all about that when we come back. Remember, you can check us out at nonpartisanlibertyforall.com. You can also check us out on Spreaker and find all of our archives, all 181 episodes already. Sounds like a lot of episodes. It's only been a little over a year, but so you can check out any of those. Probably don't listen to the early ones because they're probably terrible. But we'll be right back after this with me, Dave Bourne, and my Thursday co-host who joins us every Thursday, North Missouri Cop Block's Thomas Woody. And be sure to go to Facebook and like him on Facebook at North Missouri Cop Block. So we'll be right back. Nonpartisan Liberty for All. NonpartisanLibertyForAll.com.
After the Cleveland Browns home game on Sunday, the president of the city's police union called NFL player Andrew Hawkins, quote, pathetic, for wearing a T-shirt protesting two police killings earlier in the year. Hawkins, a Cleveland Browns wide receiver, however, is not apologizing for wearing a shirt that read, quote, justice for Tamir Rice, John Crawford, during warm-ups. Rice, a 12-year-old, was shot and killed last month by a Cleveland police officer while carrying a pellet gun. Crawford, 22, was fatally shot in that Ohio Walmart, as we mentioned, while holding an air rifle he got within the store. The Cleveland Police Union head, who is about to join me here tonight, not only disagreed with Hawkins' statement, but argued athletes had no business weighing in at all, saying, quote, it's pretty pathetic when athletes think they know the law. They should stick to what they know best on the field. The Cleveland Police protect and serve the Browns Stadium. And the Browns organization owes us an apology. He continued in another statement, quote, he's an athlete. He's someone with no facts of the case whatsoever. He should stick to playing football and let us worry about law enforcement. Earlier today, Hawkins himself defended his decision.
My mom has taught me my entire life to respect law enforcement. I have family, close friends who are incredible police officers, and I tell them all the time how they are much braver than me for it. Unfortunately, my mom also taught me that just as there are good police officers, there are some not so good police officers that would assume the worst of me without knowing anything about me for reasons I can't control. As you all know, and it's well documented, I have a 2-year-old little boy. That little boy is my entire world. And the number one reason for me wearing the T-shirt was the thought of what happened to Tamir Rice happening to my little Austin scares the living hell out of me. And my heart was broken for the parents of Tamir and John Crawford, knowing they had to live that nightmare of a reality.
And as Hawkins talked about his respect for law enforcement, he did not back down from that original statement.
To me, justice means that the innocent should be found innocent. It means that those who do wrong should get their due punishment. Ultimately, it means fair treatment. So a call for justice shouldn't offend or disrespect anybody. A call for justice shouldn't warrant an apology.
Joining me now is Detective Jeffrey Fomo, president of the Cleveland Police Patrolmen's Association. Good evening to you. You see the statement right there. Why should he or anyone have to apologize for stating their sincere views on police conduct?
Well, first off, he doesn't have the clear view of the police conduct. He's calling for justice on two officers that were called to do their job with a male that had a gun inside a park, that they had to defend themselves and use deadly force on him. So it's not a call for justice. They were justified. And Cleveland police officers work with the Cleveland Browns hand in hand, and when he disrespects two of our officers, he's disrespecting everybody else.
But, okay, you guys disagree on that. Why should he apologize to you? Why shouldn't you apologize to him? You have a disagreement about the facts of the case and how to proceed.
Well, we're not apologizing to anybody. I mean, justice, calling for justice on two of our officers, through, you know, they need to do it to us because they're disrespecting our officers on a job we do hard every day and a job that two officers were put in a position to by a male's actions.
In the statement, you talk about providing, serving and providing security for the stadium. How is that relevant?
Well, a lot of police officers work there. We are with the Browns organization. When you talk about two of our officers, doing a justified shooting, you're talking about all of us. Any one of us could have been in that circumstance.
Sure, but I mean, are you implying that it's relevant somehow? Are you implying that security would change because of this disagreement?
No, we wouldn't change. We're here for the community. We're here for the people that go to the Browns games. We're here for the public.
And when you say that he, as we read your statement, doesn't know the facts or the law, how do you apply that logic? Wouldn't that apply to any citizen who may not be a police expert but has some legitimate view of police conduct? I mean, don't you think at a certain point that this kind of reaction risks feeding the perception that some of these police unions or some folks here don't think they're accountable to public views?
You know, there's a video of this, and everything speaks for itself. Their action, the male's action, spoke for itself. I mean, the video clearly showed, and by the officer's statement, that they were justified in the deadly force.
You're saying the video clearly shows that the 12-year-old boy was an imminent lethal threat to the officers?
Oh, absolutely. I don't know if you didn't see it, but yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, we have some of it up on the screen. We're showing it. I mean, there's tremendous disagreement about that. In a lot of cases, that would constitute probable cause for a crime unless there was a lethal threat to the officers. But ultimately, that isn't your call, is it? And it's not the athlete's call. That's a call that has to go through the criminal justice system. I guess what I'm trying to get at here from your statements, and the reason why they've upset some people, is that your statements seem to presuppose that the police union or police officers have the final word on the facts here. You know that's not true. You know we have a system here of criminal justice that leaves that decision up to grand juries and the criminal justice process, right? And people are free to talk about it.
They're free to talk about it, but it shouldn't be talked on a football field where we are supporting the Browns by doing security every day when we support the Browns.
Are you saying, this is what I'm trying to understand. You just said before, of course, it wouldn't change your approach. Why does your security that you provide and police bravely provide security for entire cities, stadiums and not, why would that affect his free speech rights to voice an opinion here? I mean, you're not really answering that question.
He can voice his opinion, and that's fine, but I'm just saying that calling for justice for his opinion on what happened that day, he's wrong. And that's what I'm clearly stating. And he was cleared by a city, like these two were cleared by a city prosecutor already. This shooting was justified, and you know, like I said, it's a tragic that it was 12-year-old, but it was justified.
So to be clear then, if you're saying he can state it, then are you withdrawing the request for an apology for him to state the view, or he can state it, but he has to also apologize?
You know, I'm not saying, you know, I'm not withdrawing anything. You know, he disrespected police officers who were doing out there doing their job. He's surrounded by police officers. When you talk about two of us that were put in a situation like these two where you're talking about all of us.
And what do you think on just a more human level, if I can ask? You heard his statement talking about his child and these fears and a lot of people talking about that conversation around the country. Does your heart go out to people who are worried about their children unarmed losing their lives in these kind of incidents?
Well, it depends what you're saying, what's unarmed. I mean, this male was obviously not, he wasn't unarmed. He had what they thought to be a gun, and they also thought him to be 20 years old. If he's 20 years old, we're not sitting here today.
Sure, but you're well aware of many of the other cases. I know it's outside of your city, but the Eric Garner case or other cases. What do you think about the concern people have that folks are being killed in some cases by officers when there's less than a lethal threat posed?
How about this? Listen to police officers' commands. Listen to what we tell you, and just stop. I think that eliminates a lot of problem. I have kids, too. They know how to respect the law. They know what to do when a police officer comes up to them. I think the nation needs to realize that when we tell you to do something, do it. And if you're wrong, you're wrong. If you're right, then the courts will figure it out.
You are listening to Nonpartisan Liberty for All Radio with your host, Dave Bourne. Call in at 702-470-7664 or Skype in, username Nonpartisan Liberty for All.
Nonpartisan Liberty for All. That was the speech from the winner of Douchebag of the Year last year, I guess. That's what he was. That was actually the clip that I've played I don't know how many times now of the director. I don't know what his specific position was with the police union director or something in Cleveland where he defended the 12-year-old that was murdered by the police. And pretty much said, you know, well, if you don't follow the orders of the police, you know, then you probably won't get killed. And the sad thing is that's probably the truth. But that's where, you know, people can keep talking about we need reform, we need body cameras, we need to whatever. At what point is it, you know, are people going to realize that reform's not the issue? This is not something that just fucking started a couple months ago or a year ago. I mean, this is since the beginning of police. Just because there wasn't an internet and everybody didn't have a fucking cell phone camera does not mean that all this shit didn't go on. So they're trying to approach it from the standpoint like, oh, look, things are getting bad now. Now let's get some reform in there and we can reform it up and everything will be great. You know, our officers do a great job murdering people. I guess if their job was to, this is what I really think their job is, but is to demean people, teach them to obey, beat them and murder them, then they're doing a great job.
Dave, let me ask you, when was the last time you told your employer, person who's in control of your paycheck, the man who signs your paycheck, or woman, whoever it happens to be that you work for, if you work for somebody, or even if you don't, you're self-employed, you're still working for your customers. When was the last time you told the person that was paying you to do something that I'm not going to do something because I don't want to, I don't have to? Like a little two or three-year-old would throw a little tissy tantrum at Walmart because you won't buy them that toy that they want. When was the last time you did that and kept your job?
Well, I'm special like the people on the little bus. No, yeah, people obviously won't keep their job if they're doing that, unless, of course, you're a police officer or some other sort of government employee.
I want to bring up a situation that happened in my own personal life because, you know, the best reference anybody has is stuff that's happened to them personally. At one time, towards the end, because I was put on this, what they call probation, for this alleged possession of marijuana that I was party to, I guess. And they deemed it necessary to put me on for 5 years of supervised probation where I had to report at a weekly basis there for a while.
5 years?
Finally got down to a monthly base. Yeah, 5 years.
Was that when you were in the military?
4 years of it and they let me go. I'm off of the whole thing now. But
was that? But wait, was that when you were in the military, or normal?
I'd gotten. I was out of the military when all this happened. But the police had came in, and this is the case where I told you that they said the search warrant stands because they found drugs. So that's probable cause alone. Because they found drugs, they can come in the house. Well, they would never fucking found drugs.
Yeah, it's like magic. It's if they find something, that means that they somehow were psychic, and that was their probable cause was psychicness.
So they found the jury of my peers found me guilty of felony possession of marijuana, but not guilty of misdemeanor drug paraphernalia, which drug paraphernalia means apparatuses that are used to consume
certain
illegal
pipes
substances.
And, yeah.
So they essentially told me that, yeah, the drugs was yours, but the pipe wasn't. So we're all good now. Okay, so they put me on 5 years of probation and ordered me to do a drug court program where I had to, on a 3 times a week, there for a whole month straight, I had to report to the government and take urine analysis 3 times a week for a month straight. And the only way for me to get out of this cycle of coming in every 3 times a week.
Wait, 3 times per week?
3 times per week. I had to come in and take urine analysis. And the only way for me to not be part of this little cycle no more is I had to obtain a job. And I had to work at least 30 hours a week. If I worked 28, I had to come in 3 times a week. But when I started working a job that I worked at least 30 hours, I got to come in twice a week. And then after I came in twice a week for 6 months, they said, okay, well, since you successfully came in twice a week for 6 months, oh, and on top of this, you got to go to groups that are sponsored by the government. You get to have one-on-one sessions with a therapist, and you are required to go to Narcotics Anonymous or Alcoholics Anonymous or another support group, recovery group, they call them, of your choosing.
And what?
Twice a week.
What was the amount of marijuana that you were, I guess, found in possession of?
I had a half a pound of marijuana.
Well, that is kind of a lot, but still.
That's nothing. Half pound of marijuana, a person who suffers from chronic...
Well, what I mean is... Right. But I mean, it wasn't like, you had a couple of dime bags in your pocket or something.
No, I guess you could say I was a hardened criminal.
No, I don't think that's not what I'm saying. I'm just... You know what I mean.
But moral of the story is, I get to do all these requirements. Oh, and if you don't fulfill one of them, all you got to do is miss one meeting with the drug court caseworker, which is the guy that you have to meet with 3 times, then 2 times, and then you get to meet with him once a week. That's the final stage. You got 3 stages, and on the 3rd stage, you can meet with him once a week. On top of going to 2 meetings a week with your counselor, which you get down to 1 a week with the counselor, and then you have to go to what they call drug court, where you get to go in front of the judge, an actual judge who reviews your progress. When you're in stage 1, you got to go every Monday. When you're in stage 2, you go every other Monday. And when you're in stage 3, you go once a month for the judge to review your progress through the drug court program. And I get to do all of this, and I get the privilege of being given an SIS, suspended imposition of sentence. Meaning, even though I was found guilty by a jury of my peers for the possession of marijuana, this court refuses to enter a sentence. Instead, orders me to probation and intensive recovery programs. Now, because I completed the intensive recovery programs successfully.
How intense was it? Or was it actually just in a tent outside in the woods?
Pretty intense. It was intense, man. They are on you hardcore. There is lots of people that go through the program, and they finally succeed, because there's all sorts of sanctions they can give you for messing up.
Well, it's so fucked up that they just assume anybody. Okay, if you're not arrested for drugs, then you don't have a problem. If somehow you just get caught, that means now you have a problem and you need to go to rehab.
Exactly.
It's fucking insane.
Addicted. because you got caught by law enforcement, you're addicted.
Right. So it just because whatever, you were unlucky, but this person wasn't, you're an addict, but that person that was luckier than you, they're not an addict. It's insane.
Now, to get off my high horse and stop ranting, moral of the story is they gave me an SIS, which is a suspended imposition of sentencing, which is a step, you know, above, you know, in terms of being better than what they call an SES, which is suspended execution of sentence, which means they give you a sentence, you're sentenced to a term of imprisonment, but they don't carry the sentence out in favor of sending you to probation. Now, mine, they did not impose a sentence. So instead of imposing a sentence, they just send me straight to treatment. Now, the beauty, quote unquote, of this is that I get the privilege of having this charge completely eradicated from my record. So nobody
expunged.
Can do a background check on me, and this does not come up anywhere. And the police are not allowed to report about me ever being convicted of this. So it's like it never happened in the eyes of the law.
Well,
so I didn't lose any of my rights, even though I don't understand how you can lose a right. Rights are supposed to be unalienable, but you don't get the right to vote, even though it didn't do anything in the first place. You don't get the right to defend yourself by the use of a firearm. You don't get the right to go fishing. You don't get the right to anything, pretty much. You are a slave. Look at the 13th Amendment. You are a slave, because slavery is a punishment for crime.
Yeah, I mean, and that's a good point. I mean, how can you have a right and your right is taken away? Well, you had that right. But, you know, we the government, because we have more guns, or at least people supposedly willing to use them, than you do. So because of that, and how do people not understand that neither? That what authority does the government have? And they have the authority of, they have a military and they have a police force and they have a DHS and they have all these armed agencies. That's what they have. Because without that, they're nothing. And that's scary in a sense, too. If you want to talk about the military itself and think about all of these countries where there were military coups, where the military just took over the government, because who's going to stop them?
They got all the guns.
So why would you want, think about this for a second, in any situation, in any country, why would you want any one group or any one entity to be the only ones that have that much power? So in the case of the U.S., you can say the military. So the military being part of government, but I guess they can kind of, you know, if they wanted to branch off there, why would you want the military to be more powerful than the people? In reality, it doesn't make any sense. Of course, I guess it makes sense if you want to have a military police state, but with the exception of that, it doesn't, because you would want the people to be able to defend themselves against the military if it came down to it, if there was a military coup. But in what we were kind of talking about earlier, what I kind of broached earlier is, so, and you obviously have a different perspective on this as someone who served in the military, but I don't know that I see much of a difference anymore between the military and the police, except for the fact, and this is just for the time being, and I don't know how long this is even going to last, because the way things are going, it seems like the military will not only be for operations outside of the United States, but within them as well, if they haven't been already.
Well, Dave, I put it this way. The difference between military and the difference between police is all in the eyes of the beholder. Because essentially, whether people want to believe it or not, unless you, and whether you agree with me not, or not, the system all breaks down into you and I. You have all these people dressed up in camouflage, you know, classic get-ups that you would associate with wartime. One says DEA, one says NSA, one says sheriff, one says police, one says Air Force, one says Navy, one says Marine, and one says Army. What's the difference?
Where's the ones that say assholes?
The tag they decide to put on their suit. That's the only difference. It's all government. They're all doing the same damn thing. They're doing government. And I know lots of people see government as different and everything, but essentially, government is your dumbass giving somebody the authority to tell you what to do because you can't run your life as good as
well, them. Well, it just seems like they're giving them, I mean, they're kind of the same, but they're assigning them to different kind of areas. Yeah, like, okay, the military, you guys are going to do this outside of the United States, supposedly. Again, who knows what they're doing within the U.S., you know, and the police and, you know, the NSA and the FBI, you guys are going to do this stuff within the U.S. And the CIA, you're going to do whatever the hell you want to do because you're not really held accountable to anybody. And the State Department, same, you know, type thing. So, but really when, you know, looking at the military, somehow they're almost given a pass because of how people are conditioned to view people that aren't within the same country as them. So,
you're
like,
right.
It's okay for the military to go over and annihilate some other country, even though
they're terrorists.
In the pretty much, but even take a situation where
no, that's what they tell the people that our military, they're fighting terrorists. We got to stop the terrorists, Dave. We can't let the terrorists come and get us.
No, but I'm saying even in any example where say the ruler of a country actually is doing something bad, for example.
The ruler of the country is the terrorist?
Yeah, well, yeah, just for whatever purpose. Whatever, you know, the purposes of, I guess, this conversation. But then they go in there and they end up killing all these other people that just have nothing to do with it that are in the country. But it's okay because people are conditioned and brainwashed to believe that, you know what, that's okay. And it seems like basically what's happening in other countries or what has happened in other countries for years and years what the military has done, that now it's happening here and the police are the, you know, U.S. military per se, and it's okay for them to do it and they're doing the same thing.
Well, Dave, there's this saying that I was brought up hearing a lot, and you hear it where I was at in the military, because, you know, my department in the military, my job was to kill people. And now I had the, I guess you could say, fortunate to be able to kill them from afar, which that's not any fucking better. I specifically designed, repaired, and calibrated electronic circuits that would be installed into rockets and missiles to guide them to their target to kill bunches of people. Or, well, quote unquote, this is how it's sold to the public, is that my job was specifically to work on defense systems to protect the ship from any threat. But really, I was working on devices to kill people. I wanted to make my targets, you know, my target accusation a much narrower area of effect, you know, kill just who we wanted to kill, quote unquote. But
right, and for what reason in the first place? What war that
the war
did
on
not
terror.
That, right, the war on terror. Because what war was ever justified? Well, what about before that? You had Vietnam, you had Korea, two civil wars.
We fabricate enemies so we have a reason to fight. We build, we design. Well,
I don't build them, but yes.
Talking as a censor of the military, that we design these enemies so that we have somebody to fight. We built.
You always got to have a boogeyman.
The United States government made Al-Qaeda. We funded them. We trained them. We set up the whole organization, and now look who we're supposedly fighting, Al-Qaeda. Oh, but it's not, it's ISIS now.
Well, they had to change the name there.
It's just a fraction of
Al-Qaeda. So what fucking service are people thanking people for? Oh, thank you for your service of what? What are you doing that you deserve some fucking thanks for? And it, like I was saying at the beginning of the show, the people that I would thank are people like doing stuff that you're doing, or, you know, going out and whistleblowers and stuff like that. Because how does the fucking U.S. military protect my freedom against the U.S. government, who is, you know, abusing my rights and trying to take my rights away? I don't see the military stepping in and fucking helping with that.
Do you watch illusionists is what they're called nowadays? You know, we used to call them magicians and
illusionists, right?
Yeah, illusionists, whatever.
He's an illusionist.
That's the whole illusionist talk.
Illusionist, yeah. But, like that creepy who's that guy? Copperfield.
Chris Angel.
Well, David Copperfield was like the original.
Exactly.
He's the OG of the illusionist.
Well, I bring up Chris Angel because I've seen him in person, and that dude can pull off some crazy shit.
He looks very creepy, too.
He'll leave you saying, now what the fuck just happened? You know what I mean? But they are people, which the government has figured this out, too, that have mastered the art of making you watch one hand while they reach in your back pocket with the other hand.
Mm-hmm.
And you don't ever know what's happening until you've already been hoodwinked.
It's the Kansas City Shuffle.
There we go. You got to make him watch one hand while you smack him with the other one.
Or in the movie, you make somebody look over there and then you break their neck.
Any way you got to do it to get it done. That's the name of the game. Do it however it has to be done, as long as you finish the job. But when you're killing people, when does it stop when your job is to kill people? Because you got to have a next target, right? You got to have somebody else to kill. So it's a perpetuating, never-ending system. It's auto-ignited, and it just goes and goes and goes. And nobody wins. We all lose. And eventually, they're going to bring these people that they've trained to do this to other people because they have nobody else to fight, because the rest of the world wants nothing to do with the United States government. But the people who they have slowly bred and manipulated into a welfare system where everybody is required to rely on the government for one thing or another, these people all rely on the government, but now they're the enemy because they're abusing the system. So we have to enact laws to make these people criminals, and now we have to go lock them in cages and force them to do work that we want them to do and not pay them and feed them like shit and treat them like shit.
So, and you look at all of these things, and I made the analogy yesterday about the dam and all the holes in the dam, and you can't plug up all the holes in the dam because there are, and obviously it's an extreme example. You can try to focus on one thing, and while you're focusing on that one thing, literally a million other things have happened. So
we call it in the military the fog of war.
Well, I'm not just talking about the military. I mean, I'm talking about everything in general, because and this is something I've been talking a lot about this week as well. And I think that most people with any sense of intelligence realize that the elected officials in government are not the ones running the government. Now, there's a lot of speculation on who really is running things. Is it the multi-billionaires? Is it, you know, some Illuminati? Is it a form of, you know, both? Is it just lobbyists from the big banks? you know, but I think the majority of people see that it's not really the elected officials that are running anything. So that tells you right.
Puppets.
Well, yeah. So that tells you right there. So if we're looking at, and we could look at any issue, but say we're looking at the issue of, okay, we have a military force who seems to be training within the United States now in the next couple of months, and definitely seems to be training to possibly, I don't know if I'd use the word attack Americans, but maybe to monitor and keep them in line, and, you know, like what the police were seem to be set up to be doing with all their military vehicles. So you have that going on. But so at what point, I mean, you know that you're not really going to change anything by campaigning and going to Congress and all of this shit. And I think most people know that. That really, that's not, maybe you can change some things on a local level. That's possible. In the big scheme of things, it's not much. And, you know, again, for every one thing you're able to change, there's probably a million that just, you know, sprouted out of while you were spending all that time working on that one little thing.
You're so right, David. Let me ask you this. Now, this is something that's very controversial with a lot of people, and you see it in the media a lot. And whether you are for it or whether you're against it or neutral, whatever be your stance, you got to think of the bigger picture of these vaccinations that we're being forced to take nowadays. It wasn't too long ago when there was only 3, 5, maybe 6 vaccinations that were being taken.
You can go back, because I did this. You can actually go back and look at the year, you know, and how many were like in 1982 or 1983, and then go look at, like, you know, 1995. And, yeah, I mean, it's crazy.
In 1989, when they passed a law exempting your ability to sue vaccine manufacturers for damages caused by the vaccines. But now you ask me, but Thomas, what damages do these vaccines cause? Because everybody's telling us, the CDC, the government, is telling us, and all the government-hired scientists are telling us they're completely safe and efficacious. No, they're not. Read the inserts. They put mercury in these. They put aluminum. We know today that aluminum is a severe neurotoxin. There is lots of aluminum that are in these vaccines. And even
you can also wrap food in it.
Mercury free, because they don't use thimerosal anymore. If they are produced in a facility that manufactures thimerosal or used in anything that had thimerosal in it, it will be contaminated with thimerosal. That's the beauties of mercury. It's hard to get it gone. You can't get rid of it once you introduce it. That's the problem with mercury. And it will fucking kill you. It makes you go retarded. It gives you allergies because it destroys your gut. Your gut is the center of your life. If you don't have a gut, you have no life, because you can't digest food. If you don't eat food, you don't drink water, you die.
Yeah, but with everything else that's going on, you know, you're going to end up getting killed much quicker anyway. So
my point that I'm making is they're dumbing the population down by telling them, hey, you need a flu shot every year. A flu shot contains 25 micrograms of thimerosal. 25 micrograms of thimerosal, when you do the math, adds up to approximately 25,000 parts per billion of mercury. Mercury. Now, mercury, if it is found in a substance at a concentration of 400 parts per billion, according to the wonderful EPA, 400 parts per billion is toxic, hazardous waste. But we're going to inject 25,000 parts per billion into our body every year, alongside the wonderful influenza virus, not one, not two, not three, but 4 different influenza viruses, alongside all these other chemicals that are known to be neurotoxic.
Right, but who gives a fuck if you're sitting in a prison camp wasting away dying anyway?
So the smart people rid of with the vaccines.
What I'm saying, yeah, but vaccines seems more long term. So that's just one thing. Yeah, but what I'm saying is, okay, so that's one thing out of the millions of things. So what do you even do at this point? And I guess this is part of some of the stuff I've been focusing on this week is one. Okay, as I had mentioned earlier, nothing's going to change for the most part from, you know, Congress or campaigning or any of that shit. It's not going to happen. And I think most people recognize that. So if those aren't the people running things, you don't know who the people running things are. You know, you can speculate. And like I said, some people think they're the, well, yeah, we actually did a whole, you know, show on GMO yesterday. But you're talking about the things that are more going to kill you a little longer term. I'm talking about, what about the fact where you have a Nazi Germany-esque government, and you have people just coming in your house and confiscating everything, and you're dead right there if you stand up.
That is the bigger picture. And these situations that I'm, you know, fabricating or whatever they want to say that I'm doing, this conspiracy theories of GMOs, the conspiracy theories of all these black flag events or false flag events, excuse me, these conspiracy theories of the chemtrails.
Black flag, I think, is the shit that kills bugs.
Yeah, it's one of the products. But and that stuff, you know, all the chemicals we're putting on our food, not to mention the chemicals we're engineering into our food. Then we're taking all these vaccines that have all these toxic chemicals inside of them. So we're eating food that's toxic. We're taking drugs that are toxic. We're breathing air that is toxic. It's all catalyst to the bigger picture of the police state.
Right. No, and I understand that. And, you know, that's definitely a concern as well. But what I'm saying is those you can avoid a lot of those things yourself. So you can choose not to eat certain foods. You can choose not to take vaccines. Now, I know they could pass laws and try to physically force you, but, you know, that aside, there's certain things that you can try to avoid. But there are a lot of people that are growing organic food. If you have an army of, you know, who knows how many people banging down your door, what the fuck are you going to do at that point? So really, I guess what I'm getting at, and you see, you know, the whole Jade Helm thing and who knows what they're preparing for. I don't think anything is going to come out of that during that time necessarily, but I think there's a pretext there of, you know, maybe training for war within the country. I mean, who the fuck knows anymore? Because you look at all these things that are going on and the more control that the government is taking. So again, at what point, you know, do you just have to say, look, the only thing you can possibly do is stand up and defend yourself?
But now remember, Dave, you have to walk before you run. You have to crawl before you walk. You got to take baby steps. That's what the police state is doing. Yes, you are absolutely right. That is the ultimate goal.
But they're not really doing it anymore. They're pretty much there. They're laying down the infrastructure.
At the final stage.
They're right, exactly.
Doped us up. They've dumbed us down. Nobody sees what's going on. We're all fucking hoodwinked.
So what do you do if tomorrow the police say, okay, we're going to do door-to-door confiscations of certain things, you know, maybe partially guns or, you know, certain products we don't want people to have. And that's what they've done in all of these communist countries where they confiscate different things. So what are you going to do at that point?
If you ask me personally, I probably wouldn't, in the interest of self-preservation,
probably wouldn't want to come out in public and say, but I'm going to tell you, I ain't going to stand for it.
We're
I'm
saying hypothetically, not in reality.
No, I'm just saying what I will do, actually, if it comes down to, you know, brass tacks, you push, and you when shove, you know, push comes to shove, I'm shoving back. I'm not laying down. I would rather die on my feet than serve on my knees.
Because
that's the way I can put it.
There's this whole thing, and again, I think long term that it definitely to change things, it has to be in a peaceful way through, you know, hearts and minds, because that's the only way to maintain something, because you maintain it because that's what people believe.
We have to remind people that these assumed authority figures, they do not have any authority that you do not grant to them. You have to stop eating their products. You got to stop taking
it's
their
not
stop
they
listening
they
to their
don't
media.
But they do, because it's not as easy as that. You could say I just burped on air. You could say that, well, okay, they don't have any authority that you give to them. I guess technically you're right, but they could still break your door down with a bunch of guns and a bunch of people, and they could physically force, you know, whatever, or kill you, or so you could say, yeah, I'm not going to do this, you're going to have to kill me. But at the same time, you know, it's not just like you can stop that from happening.
If that scenario does come to pass, I'm telling you what, there is nothing that you can do unless you have your own army. But who has their own personal army, you know, shacked up in their backyard? The government does. But you're absolutely correct, Dave, and there's nothing that I can really say to be a viable point to the contrary, to counter what you're saying, because of the fact that that is the reality. They can, and they will, and they have done exactly what you're saying.
So, like, I'm not advocating for people to go out and do anything violent.
Not at all.
And I definitely, again, and think that to initiate force against anybody is wrong.
Is wrong.
But on the other side, I do believe in self-defense. And, you know, you can't tell me, not you being you, but you being anybody, because people will try to say this, that if every time the government tried to violate somebody's rights, they defended themselves, that it's not going to stop them from doing it. You know, I mean, of course it is. If every fucking time a police officer tried to violate somebody's rights and they knew what they were doing was wrong and physically violate their rights, and a person stood up and defended themselves, you know, how much longer do you think that's going to go on until some of these cops say, well, okay, I know I'm wrong, I'm not going to push it that far, because if I do, you know, stuff can happen. And that's how it should be. I mean, I brought up the Bundy, you know, standoff before, which I thought worked perfectly because nobody got hurt, which was the best thing, but people didn't back down either.
But in all reality, it could have went exactly the opposite.
It could have, but it didn't.
And that's the beauty. It didn't. But it could have.
Well, that's the problem, is because you have a lot of these cops that are hotheads that are just going to start shooting. And a lot of them are pussies at the same time. So they're just going to start shooting. If you've ever seen the movie Panther, where that was kind of the same thing that happened there, where it was just a standoff where the cops were going to violate their rights. They pulled guns out and said, no, you're not. And it was kind of like, okay, the cops knew that what they were doing was wrong. And they didn't want to have a fucking something where people got killed or got hurt. So it ended up being a standoff. And to me, that's really what should happen. And the positive part of that is that, you know, nobody does get hurt. We only got a few minutes left, so.
You're right, David. But nobody wants to be that individual that does get hurt.
Well, that's the whole thing. The first people, you know, the first person that does that is probably going to get killed by the police. You know, that's the unfortunate problem is, well, either way, either someone's going to get killed by the police or kill the police, and then they'll still get killed by the police. And don't get me wrong. I mean, with all the issues I have with the police, and I don't think police should exist. I don't think there should be government police. But I don't want, you know, I don't want anybody to die. I don't want anybody to get hurt. You know, I think some police may deserve to just, you know, kind of have a beating, but not permanent damage. You know, I don't want to see anybody's life ruined or somebody having the rest of their life in a wheelchair or some permanent damage. I don't. And maybe, you know, there's a way, I doubt this, but, you know, maybe there's a way to help cops to realize what they're doing is wrong. I mean, you know, who knows at this point? I do know.
You're right, Dave.
That it things can't continue how they are, and things are not going to change through this system. And if you're somebody like me who doesn't believe in the system in the first place, you know. But really it's just about wanting freedom and wanting not only freedom for yourself, but freedom for other people, you know, freedom for the police, freedom for these people, freedom for whoever to live their lives the way they want, as long as they don't directly, you know, interfere with other people's lives.
Whatever happened to, you know, because I'm sure you were probably told the same thing when you was a kid. I was told the same thing. I was told this, but do unto others as you'd want others to do unto you. Whatever happened to that? I'm not even religious, you know.
That was an Esau's fable. That wasn't even a religious, you know, text. That was.
It's been
It might have been a religious text too, but you know, Esau's fables would have, you know, the stuff like that in it. So
that's just pure words of wisdom to live by. Do you want somebody to come up and steal your stuff? Don't steal their stuff.
Well,
you want somebody to come and beat on you? Don't beat on them.
I think you have, you know, with a lot of these, with police and I guess these are why a lot of the so-called good ones are leaving. Although I think anybody who kidnaps somebody for choosing what to put in their body is a criminal. But is that they're seeking out these crazies, you know, the small percentage of people that are nuts. But it seems like those are the people that they're seeking out, that they're trying to find, you know, those type of people that don't think that way, that aren't thinking about others and thinking about
consequences of their actions.
Yeah, so, you know, there's people that have grown up damaged to feel that they were treated badly and they want to get back and they're mad at the world. You know, I don't know. So, but
you see kids grow up who are bullied in school, and what do? They shoot up their schools. And that's I know it's a real bad example. And
that rarely happens. And you know what? I was bullied a little when I was younger too, and I never thought of shooting up the fucking school. So,
but when it happens, though, it leaves a lasting scar that you cannot easily
forget. No, but what I'm saying is, these people that do that, it's beyond that. It's not just that. It's just like, you know, the bullshit where they could say, well, video games are why people do this, and it's like plenty of people play video games and don't do it. So. You know, Chris Rock said it best.
The cartoons that are 10 times softer today than they were in our time.
Well, yeah, that too. But you have, you know, Chris Rock said the, you know, whatever happened, it's just crazy. There are a small percentage of people that are nuts. There's not that many. But when you have, you know, millions and billions of people in the world, you know, you're going to have a certain amount of people. Even if it's 1%, it's still going to be a lot of people, but the majority of people aren't like that. But you can't create a world that is based on exceptions, that the whole world takes freedom away from 99% of the people because of the 1% of the fucked up people. So, and we only got a minute left, so I'll let you have the last words before we we end tonight's show.
Well, Dave, I don't really have much else to say that I can say in a minute. I got so much that I want to say, but it's crazy the time we're living in. And you know, everybody when they're alive, that's what they say. The craziest time is always now, and because you know nothing other than what's happening now. But history tells us a very, very, very bad story and shows us that something big is on the horizon. And people need to wake up. They need to realize that the police state is here. The police state they've been talking about since the 60s, the 70s, is here. You just got to watch your back out there.
No, I mean, there is no freedom. Is just an illusion, and it always was. I go back to, it's not, you know, the past 20 years, 30 years, 40 years. You know, government is what it is. Government is a form of control. Government is a ruling elite that rule over others, and that's how they do it. And, you know, they... especially when it came to the U.S., you know, they did a good job of fooling the people and manipulating them. And hey, we'll give you the good life to a certain extent, but you just got to, you know, go along with us. And too many people went along with it. But it's getting really bad. And people, if you want any type of freedom at all, that it's small, you know, amount that you have, if you even want a tiny bit of it, you know, people have to stand up and speak out. And I think the biggest thing is just not, like I said, noncompliance and, you know, educating people as much as possible, getting everybody together, saying that, you know, there's more of us than you and we're not complying, you know, and it doesn't have to be violent and it doesn't have to be, you know, it can be totally peaceful. But I think still within that, you know, there will be incidences of self-defense sometimes, unfortunately, and hopefully it won't be anything, you know, too bad, and people will realize where there will be standoffs where people say, hey, we know we're doing the wrong thing here, so okay, fine. I don't know.
You're right, Dave. You've got to stand up for your personal, you know, your personal individual rights. You've got to stand up for everybody else's rights. You let it happen to one person, and someone else is going to think it's okay. One turns into two, two turns into four, four turns into eight, and it multiplies really quickly. And if you want to continue the conversation with me, you can hit me up on Facebook at North Missouri Cop Block. Thanks for having me on here tonight, Dave.
And, of course, Thomas joins us every Thursday, 7 o'clock Pacific, 10 o'clock Eastern, so be sure to tune in next Thursday. But you don't just have to tune in when Thomas is on. You can tune in every other night as well, every other weeknight. So thanks, everybody, for tuning in. Have a great Memorial Day holiday, and I'm sure we'll have a lot to say about that next week and all about Memorial Day.
And just stop. The nation needs to realize that when we tell you to do something, do it. And if you're wrong, you're wrong. If you're right, then the courts will figure it out.
We don't get to take away. We're forced. But at the end of the day, each and every man should go home safe. Sometimes the use of force is necessary. You need to comply with the police officer the way the system was meant to be. Comply with the orders of police officers. Resisting arrest is a real and dangerous thing.